AutoLine Daily is brought to you by Bridgestone, passion for excellence.
This is AutoLine Daily for July 2, 2010. We've got June sales to report for the American market, and the numbers are kind of disappointing. Compared to a year ago, sales were up over 14%. But as we keep pointing out, a year ago, General Motors was in bankruptcy, Chrysler was just emerging from bankruptcy, and the economy was in shambles. A more telling comparison is with sales from the month before. From May to June, sales fell over 7%. That's because 120,000 fewer buyers showed up in showrooms in June. Sales fell short of 1 million units, and the seasonally adjusted rate, or SAR, came in at just over 11 million, according to Ward's. A number of luxury brands, though, actually had a pretty good month. BMW was up nearly 10%, Mercedes was up 2%, and both of them outsold Lexus, which was down. Porsche was up 19%, and although the numbers were small, Jaguar shot up an astonishing 75%. Amongst the large manufacturers, only Hyundai and Kia performed well. They were up nearly 7.5%. The best-selling car in the American market was the Toyota Camry, followed by the Honda Civic and Accord, then by the Corolla Matrix, whose sales Toyota groups together. Rounding out the top five with a surprisingly strong showing was the Chevrolet Malibu. On the truck side, the bestseller once again was the Ford F-Series, followed by the Chevrolet Silverado. Two smaller crossovers, the Ford Escape and Honda CR-V, placed third and fourth on the list, and the GMC Sierra rounded out the top five. One other development worthy of noting, hybrid sales dropped off 21%, the biggest drop-off of any category. All in all, June was a disappointing month. Up to now, sales had been gathering speed, and the hope was that the market would pick up sales all year long. Hopefully, this is just a temporary dip. But historically, June has always been a strong sales month, and that's what makes these numbers all the more disappointing. Yesterday, Land Rover celebrated the 40th anniversary of the Range Rover in London, and to help commemorate the event, the company showed off the new Range Rover Evoque. Not a whole lot of details were shared. It'll be available in two- and four-wheel drive, and Land Rover says this is going to be the smallest, lightest, and most fuel-efficient Range Rover ever produced. The Range Rover Evoque, which goes on sale in the U.S. next fall, will be sold in 160 countries. GM has finally announced some projected sales figures for the Chevy Volt. According to the Detroit News, the company plans to build 10,000 copies of the extended range electric car in 2011. That number is expected to increase to 30,000 in 2012. GM says it's still on track to start selling the Volt by November. In the coming days, it will let its dealer body know which stores will be allowed to sell the car and how many they can expect to receive from the first year's production run. This is because the Volt will not be available in all 50 states until at least a year after its introduction. Amongst other challenges facing the company, sales and service personnel still need training to sell and repair the car. Coming up next, we're going to take a look at just how old the average car on the road is getting to be.
Introducing Bridgestone's third generation of run flat tires with groundbreaking new Bridgestone technologies. Bridgestone run flat tires offer improved ride comfort, lower rolling resistance, and improved wear while giving you the peace of mind and comfort you need.
My guest this week on AutoLine Detroit is Stephen Polk, the CEO of RL Polk, a company that's been gathering data on cars and the people who buy them since 1921. In the following clip, he talks about how the average car on the road in the United States is now the oldest it's ever been since Polk started keeping those records.
In 2001, average new car buyer held onto their car for 48 months. That's essentially 5 years. So now, 10 years later, the average new car buyer today has held their car for 6 years. So it's actually gone up a full 25% when you look at the time over time, or 20%. That's a big jump.
Is that due to the fact that the cars are just that much better, or are we consumers poorer? What's going on there, do you think?
There was a steady increase over that decade. It didn't all happen in the last couple of years. Basically, every year from 2000 on, you saw people holding by a month or two longer than they had historically. So I think it absolutely says something about the product. I mean, the products are great. The average car on the road now is over 10 years old. That's the first time in history that's happened. You're just seeing better performance, and I think certainly economics are driving it. People are looking and say, I don't need a new car right now. This one's good for another year, and they're able to realize that.
You can watch that entire interview with Stephen Polk on our website at AutolineDetroit.tv. And joining me for that show are Jeff Green, the Detroit bureau chief for Bloomberg, and Tom Walsh, business columnist with the Detroit Free Press. A programming note here. The crew of Autoline Daily will be on vacation next week, but we've prepared a show for you each day next week that we think you are going to enjoy a lot. I don't want to give it all away right now. You'll have to wait and see what we've done. And that brings us to the end of today's report on the most important news in the global automotive industry. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.